the way in which it looks down at the microcosm of the accurately dissected human body, and at the same time, metaphorically at least, it stares upwards like a telescope at the heliocentric universe described in the very same year by Copernicus. Although the Christian authorities had suspicions, it's quite difficult to identify any religious misgivings on the part of either of these two scientists, Vesalius on the one hand and Copernicus on the other. Since the human body was unarguably God's handiwork, then the anatomical details revealed by dissection simply confirmed the ingenuity of his design, and the same principle held for the universe at large. But even if these scientific initiatives, if one can call them that, had no effect upon the authority of Scripture, one can still recognize in them the almost imperceptible hairline cracks in the rigid crust of religious creed. One of the reasons why these fracture lines were so imperceptible was the fact that the people most conspicuously responsible for the new sciences were pious Christians, for whom the very fact that it was all so sublimely mechanical and obeyed such extraordinarily inflexible and unvarying laws was itself a sign of the truth of their prior commitment to the idea of God as the divine designer and creator. For a long time, what was described as the mechanization of the world picture could coexist quite comfortably with the belief in God. Consider the piety of men such as Copernicus and Vesalius and Galileo, it's somewhat surprising that the official church was so disconcerted by the emergence of this new science. There may have been popes and cardinals who were too stupid or too prejudiced to see that science could actually reinforce belief in the omniscience and omnipotence of the Creator. They were, after all, largely unacquainted with the actual science, but they suspected that there was something odd about it, something which didn't seem quite worshipful. It was too dominated by secular curiosity rather than by respect and awe. Anyway, the religious status quo was very elaborately connected to social and political power, and science was perhaps too curious for its own good. Curiosity, it was thought, might breed contempt. Now, Galileo, for example, was unimpressed and unmoved by the fact that Copernicus' view of the structure of the universe was rejected by the church authorities.
In questions of science, the authority of a thousand is not worth the humble reasoning of a single individual.
For these early scientists, observation was more credible than revelation.
To command the professors of astronomy to confute their own observations is to command them not to see what they do see, and not to understand what they do understand.
As everyone knows, Galileo was arrested by the Catholic Inquisition, and having refused to recant his views about the universe, he was confined to house arrest for the rest of his life. One of his most enthusiastic followers was Giordano Bruno, who was imprisoned and tortured for nearly 8 years. And despite denying that he held heretical views, he was burned in a Roman flower market in 1600. What remained of his body after burning was smashed to powder by hammers and cast to the wind. The fact is that these scientists had no difficulty in reconciling their faith with their knowledge. It was oddly enough the church that behaved as if there was an inevitable conflict between religion and science.
But perhaps we ought to
pause here for a moment, because something else had been going on, which begs a whole series of questions that we haven't even begun to address. Because even as all these men of science were redrawing the image of the universe and being persecuted for it by the church, something else had happened, something within Christianity itself, which would help to pave the way towards atheism. Well, I'm referring, of course, to what every schoolboy knows as the Reformation. But the important point is that with people such as Luther, Calvin, Zwingli, and many others, the fabric of Christian faith and dogma was torn in pieces and continued to undergo even further schisms. For the first time in its history, Christianity starts to come apart. It's no longer one Catholic Church. And for potential disbelievers, these disagreements, this sectarianism, was seen as evidence that perhaps none of the dogma might be true. And this is what the church had feared might happen.
With our contentions, their irreligious humour is much strengthened. Nothing pleaseth them better than these manifold oppositions upon the matter of religion.
Some of the new sects introduced ideas which the Christian authorities regarded as little short of atheism. The Anabaptists, for example, were a group who, in spite of their protestations to the contrary, were widely regarded as atheists. And this brings us to another group, the Unitarians, who were also viewed as atheistical. Not surprisingly, since those who were burned for confirming it insisted,
Christ is not God, not the savior of the world, but a mere man, a sinful man, and an abominable idol. All who worship him are abominable idolaters. And Christ did not rise again from death to life, nor did he ascend into heaven.
For rashly expressing this, Matthew Hammond was burned at the stake by the Bishop of Norwich in 1579. Well, it's hardly surprising under these circumstances that it's extremely hard to find anyone who explicitly questions the existence of the supernatural. Nor, for that matter, can one find people actually prepared to call themselves atheists, even though plenty are accused of it. In fact, we're entering a very strange period, full of accusations and denials. And confusingly, some of those who are denying the existence of atheism are the very people who are spending most of their time trying to eradicate the very thing which they say doesn't exist. This confusing period, which was to last almost two centuries, was full of accusations, denials, and curious contradictions, and has been studied by the Cambridge historian Simon Schaffer.
There's this extraordinarily interesting ambiguity in which some of the most ferocious atheism hunters of the 16th, 17th, and 18th century can simultaneously be found saying that there's no such thing. Because one of the best arguments that the enemies of any denial of God's existence have going for them is that it's impossible so to do. And therefore, a very good argument against atheists is that there aren't any.
Many people have pretended to atheism, or have been reckoned atheists by the world, but it is justly questioned whether any man seriously adopted such a principle.
You're arguing against unicorns, you're arguing against chimeras, you're arguing against the monsters that have inhabited our minds.
'Tis very questionable there ever was such a monster in nature as a serious atheist, who lived and died so in the clear exercise of his reason and senses.
So that the high stakes for which the game is played lead to this absolutely fascinating logical problem that one is denying the existence of the position against which one is arguing.
An atheist is, I think, impossible. Most who would be thought atheists are so out of indolence because they will not give themselves time to reason.
Atheism, I think, is a label lots of very clever people try to escape. And for that reason, we have this problem looking back at the history of atheism, that even folk who surely by any standards should be judged atheists do an enormous amount of work to make sure they can't be accused of such.
So, are there any atheists at this time? Well, so many sermons are being preached, so many books written and laws passed to combat atheism, that it seems quite clear that something's going on. The convictions and doubts of the unlettered masses may not be available for academic scrutiny, but we are entering a phase during which something we can recognize as atheism is just beginning to emerge. All the same, the people who are most obviously involved in its development consistently deny that they are in any way disbelievers.
I think the word atheist stays a boo word, a word you don't want to have yourself associated with right up to the end of the 18th century and in many cases beyond. The word atheist is not a word you wear on your t-shirt, and it's what the enemy will always attribute to you.
The confusion and ambiguity of this whole period is epitomized by the fact that as early as 1600, a popular French Catholic theologian and preacher, Pierre Charron, could write in his book on wisdom,
"All religions have this in common, that they are an outrage to common sense, for they are pieced together out of a variety of elements, some of which seem so unworthy, sordid, and at odds with man's reason, that any strong and vigorous intelligence laughs at them."
The point is that from the Reformation onwards, Christianity had been undergoing an internal reconstruction at the hands of other Christians. It had nothing to do with science. And one of the most significant trends in this process was the emergence of a group to whom we generally give the name of the deists. The deists were a largely upper-class group. And as the name suggests, they certainly did believe in a deity. But they were dissatisfied with the state of Christianity, and especially with the atrocious behavior of the religious authorities of the time. So while deists accepted that there was some kind of supreme being at the dawn of creation, they often accepted little or nothing else. There were several factors which favoured the development of deism. In England, at least, there was a more tolerant atmosphere which allowed people, as long as they were members of a certain privileged class and didn't publish too widely, to speculate about the nature of Christianity. The deists insisted that all human beings shared an indelible sense of the sacred, and that beneath the surface varieties of irrational superstition and corrupt rituals, one could identify a universal monotheism that was common to all human societies. Well, initially, there was a genuine desire to redesign a new and more tolerant and humanistic form of Christianity, one that didn't put such emphasis upon miracles, which was open to reason and was more humane, but which still, nevertheless, supported the divinity of Christ, and certainly the presence of an intelligent being. Well, there are a large number of English writers and scholars who developed these ideas, starting in the early part of the 17th century with the person seen as the father of deism, Lord Herbert of Charbury. Lord Herbert, who was born in 1582, was an aristocratic writer of metaphysical poetry, a man who was incontinently amorous. He claimed that some of society's greatest beauties kept their secret portraits of him tucked into their cleavages. But when he was not distributing these miniature self-portraits, he wrote